Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to talk about our takeaways and, you know, just our thoughts on game one of the NBA Finals between the Milwaukee Bucks and the Phoenix Suns. But before we hop into all that, I want to give a quick shout out to our subscriber today. And today is going to be Sam Vincent. Thank you so much for like, commenting, subscribing, turn on post notifications, and just, you know, supporting our YouTube channel and our podcast overall. But let's get right into this episode because I really want to dissect, you know, what we thought about this entire game and everything. And I want to start off with Greg, your thoughts and everything. What do you think that Milwaukee should have done betterly from an offensive standpoint and a defensive standpoint to, you know, really come out with a win and take a series lead in the NBA Finals?
Well, offensive-wise, Giannis played good tonight coming off that high-percentage knee. I thought he played really well, 20-17, very aggressive, got to the line, and just played his game. But his backcourt did not help him tonight. And I think that the reason why they didn't play was the Suns' defense. I think they had the matchup zone and made Milwaukee play a lot of isolation ball, which that's not really their strengths. So Jrue Holiday really had to try to play make and do the things that he's kind of uncomfortable with, and it showed. He was 4 for 14, 10 points, turned the ball over 3 times, and Chris Middleton the same. Even though you look at the box score, you're like, ooh, he had 29, but it was a hard 29 points. Like he was 5 for 12 from the three-point line, 12 for 26. A lot of those three-pointers were contested. Some of those mid-rangers were contested.
I got a question about Chris Middleton real quick. I hate to interrupt you. But, I mean, obviously, like, Mike Budenholzer, that offense that, you know, the Bucks run and everything, it's gotten a little bit better when it comes to, you know, just the fluidity of the entire offense and everything, like the decision making from the point guard position. But if you're Mike Budenholzer, I think you have to, you know, find different ways to get Chris Middleton going, because isolation basketball, you're not going to win a championship simply off that. And then, I mean, what are your suggestions? Should he do some pinaways, have him come down pin downs and everything like that, you know, kind of use Chris Middleton the way that, you know, Doc Rivers tried to use Paul George, essentially. So, I mean, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, the pin downs coming off balls, I think. I really like Chris Middleton where he's ball handling Giannis as a screener. I really like that action because it's kind of hard to guard. I think with Middleton's ability to hit the mid-range and Giannis rolling to the basket, I think that can get you some easy, quick baskets. But, yeah, just manipulate, make it hard for the Suns. I think it was very easy for them just to come down the court and just know what the Bucks are about to do this game, and it was very easy. And they created turnovers, especially the way that they were playing on defense, and they were very in the past lanes, active hands. They're just creating a lot of turnovers between Middleton and Holiday, and it just worked for the Suns, and it was a reason why the Bucks really, really struggled this game. And one thing about Middleton, game ones in this playoffs, he's in the whole playoffs in 2021, he's only averaged 15 points, shooting 30-something percent. So in game one, this is a guy who struggles in game ones, but picks it up towards the end of the series. And in the NBA Finals, as your second star, quote unquote, he's got to show up in games like this and be more efficient, be more aggressive. So I want to see Chris Middleton come out and be more aggressive and be more consistent when the series goes to the Bucks and to help them win, for sure.
Yeah, and I think defensively it's going to be really tough for them to be able to guard, because essentially, like, I think it's safe to say Phoenix roster is a lot deeper than what Milwaukee has. I mean, on the bench they got guys like Bobby Portis and, you know, Brent Forbes, but it really only goes about that 7-8 guys deep. And, you know, with Phoenix being able to have so many fresh guys who are just ready constantly. I mean, we see Frank Kaminsky ready to go. He played about 2 minutes when, you know, Dario Saric getting banged up, injuring his right or left knee. I forget which one it was. But obviously, like, it just feels like the reason why I really think that, you know, the Suns will win this series, and I'm not going to put any games on it. I'll probably say hopefully the series goes, you know, no less than 6 games, because I like watching NBA basketball, obviously. But I think, you know, Monty Williams, he does a lot better job, you know, just preparing his guys. I mean, we've seen, you know, the impact that not only he has had, but Chris Paul has had on this unit. I mean, from day one, essentially. I mean, you can date back to the bubble. You know, this team, they look really complete. And, you know, heading into the bubble, I mean, they weren't, you know, the terrible Suns that they typically look like in years past and everything. They looked a little bit more mature from an offensive standpoint. Defensively, probably could have used a little bit more work. But Monty Williams, we definitely have to tip our hat off to where he's gotten this team. especially being able, you know, bring in guys like Chris Paul and, you know, Jay Crowder. Obviously, James Jones is doing a great job as an executive. He just won executive of the year and everything. But Phoenix, I think in order for them to win this series, they have to continue to dominate when it comes to points in the paint, because I think that's going to be one of the biggest X factors, you know, aside from guys like DeAndre Ayton and, you know, the rest of their role players stepping up. Because when it comes to that, like I said, Phoenix, their depth is just a lot more. Milwaukee, they can't really compete when it comes to that, because obviously you have your big three with Drew Holiday, Chris Middleton, and Giannis Antetokounmpo, and it's just gonna be tough to, you know, really compete with these guys, because offensively it seems like, you know, they're just light years ahead of Milwaukee from that standpoint. And then defensively, you know, the continuity, it really shows on that side of the basketball, everybody having a lot of communication. I think that was one of the biggest problems when it comes to Milwaukee Bucks. Obviously, Giannis Antetokounmpo, he's going to be the guy that, you know, is kind of the anchor of that defense. We already saw the chase down block. It was a really tremendous effort on Giannis Antetokounmpo's end of the basketball. But
yeah,
as a collective unit, it doesn't seem like, you know, they really have that leader that's really going to be the voice of that side of the basketball. You'd think it'd be guys like Drew Holiday, but essentially tonight it just wasn't.
No, it wasn't. I think you're right on the nose. I don't know what the Bucks did in their film sessions the day before, but it just seemed like they just weren't prepared to play. And I think the Suns were. They came out and they hustled. They got all the 50-50 balls. They were active hands, very pesty, acted like a gnat on the floor, like just got after it. They got everything. Like, I think there was one time someone missed a layup or a shot, and the ball was like really, really right by Drew Holiday. He could have grabbed the rebound, but Ayton got it and put it back up. So it's just stuff like that. Just a small 50-50 balls is the reason why the Suns won today, and the free throw line. I think Devin Booker, who struggled 8 for 21, 1 for 8 from 3-point line, but he was super aggressive and got a lot of foul calls that I sometimes did not agree with, but he got to the line 10 times and knocked down all his free throws. And as a team, they shot 96%. So I think them being aggressive and getting to the line and getting a lot of foul calls, that also helped them this game too.
And just going back to the Suns' offense once again, I mean, it's really going to be tough for them to guard, let alone anybody, you know, in the NBA to guard these guys, because their offense is just so fluid. You have so many guys that can hurt you. It's kind of tough for, you know, the Milwaukee Bucks to make any adjustments, because it's like, okay, you could try to pack the paint and kind of take away Ayton, but that's going to leave shooters like Jay Crowder, Mikal Bridges, and Cam Johnson open. And we already know how deadly they can be from the perimeter outside. So it's like, you kind of have to pick your poison. And then when it comes, you know, trying to take away the three-point line, well, you definitely don't want to give, you know, guys like DeAndre Ayton, like I said, going from an offensive standpoint, you know, having Chris Paul get below the free throw line and doing those snake dribbles, getting to his mid-post jump shot and everything. So it's really just the Milwaukee Bucks, they're in a tough spot. And that's why I think, you know, it's going to come down to one of the biggest aspects is going to come down to coaching, because Mike Budenholzer, he is, you know, somebody who's shown that he's capable of making adjustments, but I think his adjustments come too late. You can't wait an entire 48-minute game, you know, make an adjustment heading into the following game. You have to make adjustments in game, second quarter, you know, things like that. When he decided to throw Giannis in at the center position, obviously it looked like the Milwaukee Bucks, their offense looked a lot more fluid. They were able to have a lot more spacing, and obviously everybody was just able to operate a lot better. So, I mean, those are just my thoughts on that. I mean, obviously, once again, like the mismatches, Tucker being on Ayton, Devin Booker, and Chris Paul taking advantage of Brook Lopez in a pick and roll and things like that. It's going to be really tough for Milwaukee to find ways to win if they're just going to get killed with all these mismatches.
Yeah, if I'm the Suns, I think I tweeted it too. If I'm the Suns, I'm going straight at Brook Lopez every single possession. Make him make a decision on how he's going to guard the pick and roll, because he has struggled mightily this playoffs doing that.
Yeah, and on top of that, I mean, it also comes down to the little things. Milwaukee, they had a lot of second chance opportunities
that
to put
missed
some points in the basket. I mean, coming up, you know, with extra steals, you know, just giving it right back to Phoenix. I think Milwaukee, if they were capitalizing on some of those possessions, scoreboard might have looked a little bit different. And on top of that, we also have to take into account that, yes, Giannis was injured. Only took 11 shots tonight, 6 of 11, 20 points, I think 17 rebounds. But you got to get help from your secondary and guys like Chris Middleton and, you know, your third option and Drew Holiday. Once again, Drew Holiday, I think we have to give credit to the Phoenix Suns defense. They did a good job, you know, taking away his playmaking ability, really crowding that side of the basketball for Drew Holiday, not really being able to, you know, get downhill or, you know, really create for anybody essentially. Yeah, he got a few lobs off to Giannis and Brook Lopez in a half court set, but besides that, it's kind of weird looking up at the end of the game and seeing that this guy had finished with 9 assists. So
yeah.
But I mean, do you have any final thoughts on, you know, what Phoenix should do heading into game two? Should they make any more adjustments, or should they stick to their game plan?
I think I like the matchup zone, because that challenges the Bucks to play the ISO ball, and they definitely struggle. And I think they will continue to struggle if they don't figure out how they can help guys like Chris Middleton and Jrue Holiday get the shots and get to their spots. But I think Phoenix can continue that pick and roll, continue to challenge Brook Lopez on the defensive end, making those guys come to Chris Paul and find easy buckets in the paint with DeAndre and get those shooters open. I love what Cam Johnson and Mikal Bridges did tonight, bringing in 14 and 10. So both of those guys are really knocking down open threes and doing their part and hustling on defense and bringing good minutes. So continue doing what you're doing and keep playing good defense and keep Giannis is going to get his. That's something you're going to have to live with. So, but if you can stop, if you can limit Jrue Holiday and Chris Middleton from doing what they do, I think they're going to win the series easily.
Yeah, and I think if you're Milwaukee, when it comes to, you know, experimenting with Giannis, I don't think you have to really worry too much about that. For the most part, like you said, he probably is going to get what he's going to get. I would like to see, from an offensive standpoint, them rely on kind of throw some DHOs out there, you know, some dribble handoffs with Chris Middleton, Jrue Holiday, you know, kind of, you know, just mix it up a little bit instead of, you know, forcing Chris Middleton, you know, just create on his own, kind of make it a little bit easier for this guy. And I think that can, you know, is going to open up Jrue Holiday's game a little bit more as well, because, you know, there's going to be a lot more ball movement and, you know, more player movement within this offense. But
I totally agree. And also one thing that I saw the Suns did too, they changed up the pace with Chris Paul. You know, normally Chris Paul likes to play slow, a little methodical, kind of slow tempo. He puts the pace a little bit and got in front of the defense. I like that. I think the Milwaukee Bucks should do that if they want to get easier baskets.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously, yeah, they definitely played the Phoenix pace tonight, and you can't be doing that because obviously they're going to be a team that gets a lot of possessions because they play a lot quicker. And obviously, you know, that's what benefits that offense. But I felt like late in the fourth quarter, especially, they should have tried to slow it down a little, because, you know, that 10, when you play fast paced for an entire 48 minute game, you're not only are you going to have your players, you know, kind of get a little bit fatigued, but you're also going to give, you know, the opposing team a little bit more extra possessions than you want. So I feel like towards the end of the game, they definitely should have slowed it down a little bit with Chris Paul and, you know, the rest of those guys out there. But other than that, Phoenix, we already know when they have a 10 plus point lead, they're 11-0 this entire postseason. So you definitely don't want to let those guys get going early and, you know, really dig yourself a hole defensively. But let me know what you guys think in the comment section. Thank you so much for tuning in to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Glad to be back. We're going to start pushing more episodes out for you guys. There's been a lot of news out here in the sports media and everything, and we can't wait to, you know, share our thoughts on some of these topics and everything. But, you know, besides that, make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. Turn on post notifications and give us a 5-star rating and a nice review if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. But besides that, it's your boy, Nicey Chunga Vinny. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King, and we out.
We out.